No joke, but this place has a serious issue with water. Water here has changed the course of war, started fights with neighboring countries and dominates the city's political agenda. And yet, this country is a role model.
Singapore got it right. As simple as that.
This is how Singapore is transforming itself from one of the most water-stressed countries in the world to self-sufficiency, from water racks to riches. Welcome to Singapore, a vibrant multicultural city-state right on the equator. Densely populated, around 6 million people live on this tiny island. It's an international hub for trade and finance. It's clean, safe, modern, wealthy, green. Basically, it has a lot of everything you'd want. There's just that one thing. Singapore has no natural freshwater resources, and the way its economy and population are growing, total water demand could almost double by 2060. But Singapore is on it.
None of what they've done is magic.
That's Peter Gleick. He's an award-winning water expert. He put Singapore's success down to what he calls the soft path approach to their problems.
So the soft path for water is in contrast to what we have done over the last century and more than a century, the hard path to build hard infrastructure, to take more and more water out of nature, to ignore the consequences of our water policies for nature, to build narrow institutions. And the soft path tries to turn that around and say, let's use water efficiently and carefully. Let's stop wasting water. Let's look at new sources of supply.
To understand how Singapore can pull this off, you first need to understand where they're coming from.
The Singapore water story starts with World War II.
That's John Church, the guy for water at the United Nations. Singaporeans would argue that the story goes back a lot longer, but 1942 is certainly when the issue grabbed the world's attention. That's when Allied troops, namely British, Australian and Indian forces, were battling fascist Japan on Singapore Island, which at the time was a British colony. The Allies depended on imported water, which was a bit of a problem when Japanese forces blew up the pipes transporting that water.
The bridge that connects Malaysia and Singapore was bombed. The result was a lack of water in the city, a terrible episode of water scarcity.
The Allies lost the Battle of Singapore, but after Japan's overall surrender, the island remained in British hands. It took more than 20 years until it became fully independent. But political liberation didn't free Singapore from its water crisis. Water rationing, catastrophic sanitation and regular floods continued. With its fate now in its own hands, Singapore began planning for the long term. Cecilia Tortajada has spent almost 3 decades researching water policy and innovations around the world and is fascinated by Singapore's path.
When Singapore became independent, they started planning to be water independent as well as food independent, energy independent. Well, they are dependent, but to have systems that can sustain stress. That was in 1965 for 2060.
Their initial master plan was fine-tuned over the years into a water strategy, which they call their 4 national taps. First, water imports. Second, desalination. Third, local catchment. And fourth, something they call new water. Let's dive into it. Firstly, Singapore knew there was plenty of water right here. 2 deals to import water from Malaysia in the 60s got the taps running again. It's cheap and millions of liters are pumped over the border every day. But buying half of your water from your neighbor isn't sustainable long term. On the contrary, from the start, Malaysia made threats to cut off the supply and argued over its price. The tensions have even led to warnings of a military conflict. Singapore leaders know their weak spot, so they want to stop importing water by 2061. So it's all more important that the other 3 taps become more than a drop in the ocean.
Water planning is very important because they have so little water. Singapore must make sure that this water is used wisely. And the objective of this master plan is to make the most out of every single drop of water.
This means keeping rivers and drains clean, investing billions, starting to collect more water, cleaning it and use what the island state Singapore already has. For example, this, the ocean.
desalination.
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 You take that undrinkable salt water, you remove the salt, and you have an unlimited supply of fresh water.
Do you remember? We had an entire video about obtaining fresh water through desalination. It's used in a number of extremely dry places around the world and is a real game changer for some.
Membrane desalination uses pressure. Salt water, here colored in red for clarity, is pressed through a membrane that is only partially permeable. Fresh water can pass through, here colored in blue, but the salt is trapped on the other side.
Singapore really pushed to advance this technology. This underground facility, for example, is state of the art. Normally, it treats used water. In times of drought, it desalinates seawater. On top, people use it as a park. Today, 5 desalination plants provide up to 25% of the entire island's water supply. Singapore plans to increase this capacity to meet 30% of its needs in 2060, by which time water use is expected to have doubled. But that's no way near self-sufficiency. So what's next? Bingo. Rain. A lot of it. And Singapore is a master of maxing that out. 2/3 of the entire state's surface is used for rainwater catchment.
Basically, the water falls on the roof and then goes through drains. And then you make sure that as little water leaks from the drains and is captured by the drainage system and conveyed to reservoirs where it can be stored and treated for further use.
An extensive network of rivers, canals and drains channels the water into 17 reservoirs. The biggest is Marina Barrage, with an area of 10,000 hectares. It holds back fresh water from flowing into the ocean and helps to control frequent floods. So does this underground tank that catches flood water in extreme cases when the drains spill over. Even this water could potentially be treated and reused. By 2060, the government wants to use 90% of the land area for rain catchment. Catching rainwater is one thing, but what about the water already in circulation?
All drainage water is collected and treated and reused as much as possible. Most countries, they do not invest not even a fraction of what Singapore is investing.
The water authorities built a 206-kilometer sewage pipe highway, costing $10 billion, that guides the city's sewage into state-of-the-art reclamation and cleaning facilities. Okay, Singapore is by some measures the 5th richest country in the world, so it can afford to splash out like that. It's also a lot easier to push through such projects when you have the sort of controlled democracy run by the same party that Singapore has had since independence in 1965. Anyway, the entire city's underground is basically one big sewer network. But the pride of Singapore's water strategy is what happens after collecting the water, the treatment. The authorities call it new water. It's produced by microfiltration, reverse osmosis and UV radiation.
Some of that water is so high quality, Singapore is using it in their chip manufacturing industry, which requires ultra-pure water, which is an indication of how good a quality of that water is.
Did you know that around the world, half of our wastewater is released untreated? And only 11% is actually reused. In Singapore, about 30% of the entire drinkable and non-drinkable demand can be met by recycling used water. And they want to increase that to 55% by 2060. Most of it is used by industry. Only a fraction of it is mixed into the drinking water supply, because we're all so squeamish.
It's controversial because we're taking wastewater, which, you know, we goes down our drains, we flush it down our toilets, industry dumps wastewater. And we typically think of that as a liability, as something to get rid of.
So how do you get people on board?
Using the Flush Save Assistant bag and save with every flush.
Make saving water pay.
Reduce water consumption. Save up to 10 liters of water per hour.
Nationwide campaigns encourage people to install water saving fittings. And nicely, if you install those fittings, you get discount vouchers for other sustainable products. Digital water meters track each household's water consumption and detect leaks in pipes. That's how Singapore comes down to an incredible 5% water loss from leaks, which is first class. Globally, the average is estimated to be 30%.
What they've done incredibly well, in my opinion, is on the side of water education. They've educated their community about their water situation, about their water challenges, and about the solutions that they've chosen to push.
As good as Singapore is doing, it has big advantages over other countries. Besides being rich and a tightly controlled society, the city only has a tiny agricultural sector and can focus almost entirely on urban and industrial wastewater. So they have one problem less, as food production pollutes and consumes enormous amounts of fresh water in many parts of the world. Despite that, they've shown a lot is possible.
Everywhere in the world, when we see our management, how can it be improved? Who would be involved? How can we pay for it? There is always the but can we do it? But, and in Singapore is not, in Singapore is how is it that we are going to do it? So it's a very different perspective. It's proactive. It is, they move very fast. So once there is a decision has been taken, the things start happening.
So to sum up, incentivizing low-cost water-saving fittings could be easy for every government to implement. Desalination is only an option for coastal regions, and it requires a lot of energy, often dirty fossil fuels. Singapore's catchment, treatment and purification facilities are world-class, as the result of a lot of investment in innovation and research.
But it turns out that a dollar invested in an efficiency improvement is much more productive than a dollar invested in new supply.
Reusing wastewater seems a no-brainer. It's safe and tested to work, and the tech is available.
And this is really important to find the best solutions to every country's problems, but also long-term planning. Singapore, from all the way from independence, has been planning its way through water security. Singapore is extremely high on the political agenda, all the way up to the prime minister. It's something which is mainstreamed in each and every policy adopted and implemented by the country.
Singapore is blazing a trail in tackling some of the world's biggest water challenges in the face of climate change. It's not just about money, but also about decision-making, policy and long-term planning. Some of the ingredients with which any region could make it from water rags to riches.